Well, good day, everyone. And I say good day because we are traversing many different time zones right now. So wherever you are, I hope you're having a good day. My name is Greg Dunaway, and I serve as the Dean of the Eberly College of Arts and Sciences at West Virginia University. And I'm coming to you from a very snowy Morgantown, West Virginia. It is my great pleasure to welcome you to the Gandhi-King lecture today. I believe we have an excellent program prepared for you, and we are very fortunate to have two extraordinary individuals with us today to share their thoughts on the legacies of Mahatma Gandhi and Martin Luther King Jr. We are proud to host the Gandhi-King lecture series on international relations and peace studies. This important event is sponsored through a generous gift by members of our university Indian community. And there are many people who have contributed, but special thanks is deserved to both Dr. Rashid Majumdar and Dr. V.K. Raju. The goal of this series is to celebrate the work and wisdom of Mahatma Gandhi and Martin Luther King Jr. Through this annual lecture, our communities discuss the ongoing significance of a peaceful, nonviolent approach to dealing with national and international problems and conflict. It is hoped that this event will encourage our communities to understand the importance of the legacy of both Gandhi and King. I also want to make a special acknowledgement to Dr. Lupe Davidson for organizing this wonderful event. Lupe will help me moderate the talk today. And I'd also like to thank Dylan Butler, who has assisted Lupe with the preparations for today's event. As you no doubt know, we hold our event on a day in which we honor, commemorate, and celebrate the work and aspirations of our nation's most notable crusader for civil rights and justice. It is fitting to remember that King's work was inspired and influenced by the teachings of Mahatma Gandhi and his commitment to nonviolence as a form of both resistance and protest to eradicate oppressive authority structures. I am indeed very grateful that you're able to join us today. In some ways, it would be nice to gather in person. However, the pandemic still precludes us from doing so, as well as the aforementioned snowstorm we have today. The good thing is that we're able to use our technology in order to bring people together who may not have already been able to take the opportunity to participate in person, including our speakers. Thus, I'm delighted that our event is both transnational and transcontinental. Our lecture title, Bending Towards Justice, draws from an M.L. King quote, which states that the arc of a moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. This statement is both pragmatic and hopeful. In the nearly 55 years since King's assassination, we can surely observe progress in the areas of racial equality. But so too can we cite many setbacks and impediments to furthering racial and social justice. Over the past few years, we have been reminded that inequalities are replete within our society as they pertain to health, education, justice, and enfranchisement. So our journey is long, and we clearly have a long way to go. But we cannot and should not lose heart because the path does bend towards justice. We can take solace that justice and equality will ultimately prevail as long as we stay committed and work for these goals. The full quote begins by noting, "We shall overcome because the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice, and so we shall." Before I introduce our speakers today, I'd like to introduce Professor Duncan Lorimer, who is serving as our college's Associate Dean for Research, as well as our interim chair for our Department of Physics and Astronomy. Duncan is also a fantastic musician, and we have a clip where he will play a musical selection, Lift Every Voice and Sing. Thank you. Thanks so very much to Duncan Lorimer. That was beautiful. I would now like to invite Professor Bonnie Brown, who is our Director of Native American Studies Program at WVU, to give the WVU Land Acknowledgement Statement. Bonnie?
Thank you, Dean Dunaway. WVU, with its statewide institutional presence, resides on land that includes ancestral lands of the Shawnee, Lenape, or Delaware, Cherokee, and Haudenosaunee, or Iroquois, including the Seneca, Cayuga, Onondaga, Oneida, Mohawk, and Tuscarora, and other Indigenous peoples. In acknowledging this, we recognize and appreciate all those Indigenous nations whose lands we are living on and working in. Indigenous peoples have been in the land currently known as West Virginia since time immemorial. It is important that we understand both the context that has brought our university community to reside on this land and our place within this long history. We also recognize that colonialism is a current, ongoing process, and as scholars seeking truth and understanding, we need to be mindful of our present participation in this process.
Thank you, Bonnie. It is now my distinct privilege to introduce today's speakers, Drs. Rajesh Tandon and Bud Hall. Dr. Rajesh Tandon was born in a family of teachers in the city of Kanpur in India. After completing his electronics engineering degree, he went on to do an MBA and then ultimately a Ph.D. in organizational behavior from the School of Management at Case Western Reserve University in Cleveland, Ohio. Inspired by community knowledge and a commitment for working towards empowerment of the excluded, Tandon went on to set up PREA, a civil society research and training center on participatory research in New Delhi, India. He has supported independent, competent, and resilient civil society in the global South and as an intervention in inclusive development and participatory democracy. Committed to lifelong learning, gender equality, and human rights, Tandon is currently co-chair of the UNESCO Chair in Community-Based, and Social Responsibility in Higher Education. Tandon continues to engage with youth in higher education and institutions towards freedoms and equality in the Global South. Please welcome Dr. Rajesh Tandon. Dr. Bud Hall is a grandfather of three grandsons, father of two sons, and a partner of the scholar Darlene Clover. Bud is currently the co-chair as well of UNESCO Chair in Community-Based Research and Social Responsibility in Higher Education based at the University of Victoria in Canada. A Canadian for 45 years, Bud was originally born in the USA and came to social justice awareness during the US Civil Rights era. His work has been influenced by global thinkers such as the late Julius Nyerere of Tanzania, Amilcare Cabral of Guinea-Bissau, and Paulo Ferrer of Brazil. Bud is best known for his work on knowledge and democracy, participatory research, and social movement learning. Bud is also a poet. We are delighted to have both Drs. Tandon and Hall join us today. Please let me turn it over to them, where they will talk about bending towards justice.
Thank you very much. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to all of you. It's a great pleasure for us to be able to be here. We'd like to thank you, Gregory, Duncan, Lupe, and Bonnie, for your introductions and the thoughtful land acknowledgement. We're both deeply honored to have been invited to share in this conversation some of our thoughts on how the ideas of Gandhiji and Martin Luther King Jr. relate to higher education and social justice. Today is an important day. It's Martin Luther King Day. We're reminded of the tragic similarity that both Martin Luther King Jr. and Gandhiji were assassinated. Martin Luther King was only 39 years old when I went back to my history. I couldn't believe 39. So today is a powerful time for us to reflect. It's a time of fear, but also a time of hope. And we've agreed that I would begin the conversation. So let me begin by acknowledging that I am privileged to live and speak with you today from the lands of the Lekwungen speaking peoples, known as the Songhees, the Esquimalt, and the Saanich First Nations, who've been on this island of Vancouver Island, where I live, for over 12,000 years. I live in the city of Victoria, just 1 hour from land that in 1865, my settler ancestors stole from the Hualalt First Nations. As Gregory said, I was born in the US of a settler family with roots in Canada and England. And I came to political consciousness in the 1960s, inspired by the US civil rights movement, and in particular, by the vision and leadership of Martin Luther King Jr., Rosa Parks, John Lewis, and their generation. I left the USA to live in Africa for many years before settling with my family in Canada in the mid-1970s. With full awareness of the history of genocide and colonization, which has taken place in both Canada and the USA, and continues in some aspects today, I want to start with the words of Martin Luther King Jr. He said, "We, the disinherited of this land, we who have been oppressed so long, are tired of going through the long night of captivity. And now we are reaching out for the daybreak of freedom and justice and equality." While still attending Morehouse College in Atlanta, Georgia, Martin Luther King Jr. spoke of the function of education. He says, "The function of education, therefore, is to teach one to think intensively and to think critically. But education which stops with efficiency may prove the greatest menace to society. The most dangerous criminal may be the person gifted with reason, but no morals." As I was beginning to think about how I might approach this conversation, I found myself thinking about the work of two people that I've been working with over the past months, and in fact, over several years. One person is a recent doctoral student whose work I have been supervising. The other is Dr. Wanotsa Williams, an Indigenous professor with whom I've been working on a number of UNESCO projects. Both of them, in powerful ways, have told me that universities, that higher education has not served people like them. My doctoral student comes from a background of generational poverty. He has recently finished a PhD thesis that documents the struggles against erasure that people like ourselves have experienced in university. Erasure of the knowledge which students of generational poverty bring to the academic world, erasure of the meaning of daily struggles for survival to pay rent, dental care, buy academic materials, have transportation to class, erasure of the concept of poverty class from the list of inequalities that university take into account. Lorna Williams, Wanotsa, has said directly to me recently in a conversation that higher education is not working for Indigenous people. It does not provide them with the foundations of their own cultures, and with respect for Indigenous ways of knowing, with a vision of how ecologies of knowledge, where Indigenous and Western systems might support the moral universe, or what King called the beloved kingdom. Higher education systems continue in this type of erasure that both my student and Wanotsa speak of. So I wonder, is this what Martin Luther King refers to when he says, education which stops with efficiency, may prove the greatest menace to society? The pursuit of the moral universe is one of the things that draws the thinking of King and Gandhiji together. King organized, preached, and exhorted people to work towards what he called the beloved kingdom. The beloved kingdom was that place where love prevailed over oppression and where all people were treated equally. This would have been a kingdom where the spirit of the gods of India and the God of the historic Black Church of the USA would reign over all people. So let me invite my friend Rajesh into this conversation. Rajesh, what came to mind as you began thinking about this, this conversation?
Thank you very much, Bud, for sharing your initial thoughts. I feel very privileged to be able to participate in this important conversation today on this historic day, Martin Luther King Jr. I, of course, born and grew up on the banks of Ganges in India, cities of Kanpur, Lucknow, and Allahabad. I never met Gandhi or Martin Luther King Jr. But I grew up in a family of generations of teachers. And in our family, as a child, I remember that we used to hear stories of participation in freedom struggle when Gandhiji gave call for resistance, for protest. And his inspiration for students and young people was to also pursue education, but dedicated to the cause of freedom struggle. My grandfather was one of the first Indians to head a Christchurch College in Kanpur. And my mother was the first woman to complete graduation in the city. But they inspired us to work and think about the life of Gandhi. And as I was preparing for this conversation, I recall how Mahatma Gandhi started as Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi from the western coast of Gujarat in a reasonably well-off family, finished his high school and went to study law in UK on a ship at that time, and returned to India to practice law. But as we learned, he did not find much interesting work at that time. And so through some common contact, went to South Africa. He went initially only for 1 year to fight a case of his contact. And in fact, at the end of the first year, a farewell was organized to send him off back to India. But Gandhi stayed back. Gandhi stayed back because he experienced, for the first time in his life, perhaps, discrimination and injustice. And he began to, therefore, create options that could prepare people to work, to question, to challenge that discrimination and injustice. So in 1893, at the age of 24, Mahatma Gandhi went to South Africa. And then he lived there for 21 years. And the most interesting thing is that his effort to practice satyagraha, the call of truth, that satyagraha as a nonviolent method of resistance and protest was actually invented on the soil of South Africa and then used there, but further in India. It is also important to remember at this juncture of our global history, as Bud mentioned, they were both assassinated. Mahatma Gandhi was assassinated despite his commitment to inclusion of all religions, despite his commitment to invitation for all religions to work together. He was assassinated by people of his own religion, Hindu religion, in 1948. But before we move further, let me request my colleague Nikita to play a short clip of a prayer that we all grew up listening and singing when we thought of Mahatma Gandhi, his birth centenary, or any function which was important for Gandhi's life. So let's listen to that. Many of you may have already heard it several times. What does it mean? Who would you call a good person? A person who feels the pain of others, who understands the difficulty that others experience and takes some steps to address that. That person is a good person. Exalted person, a superior person, a human being. And this was the message of Gandhi. I want to also tell you that Gandhi's experiments in education began on the soil of South Africa as well. He set up two farms along with his friends, the Tolstoy farm and Phoenix farm, and many of you may have read and heard about it. And he wanted to set up a system of education which was not borrowed from colonial practices. He was against the use of colonial language in teaching in education. And he wanted education to be holistic and linked to life and living. He put his own children to same schools in South Africa, and he realized that there were children from many different linguistic groups, from Tamil, from Parsi, from Urdu, Arabic, Telugu, Zulu. And he had to find a way so that they could learn in their mother tongues, but also connect with other kids and therefore appreciate their cultures and their ways of living. It is this experience in South Africa that later on Gandhi elaborated and came to be known as Nayi Talim, or new education. And I'll come back to that when we explore its relevance to today's context, particularly in light of institutions of higher education. And this is where I want to invite you, Bud, to connect Martin Luther King Jr.'s own perspectives on justice and struggle to what can be the role of knowledge and how it can be harnessed.
Thank you very much, Rajesh, for the background on Gandhiji. There are several contexts in higher education today that are relevant in thinking about the what can we learn from Martin Luther King or from Gandhi. And one of the most powerful lessons or most powerful challenges that we face in higher education, if you know, thinking about what Rajesh was just saying about the struggle that Gandhi had to, you know, to create a way of learning in diverse mother tongues. King was very struggled for the unveiling of truth. He struggled to pull back the curtains, on more knowledge systems. He said that the white knowledge was not the only knowledge, and that the history of Black people, the history of slavery, the history of Africa were powerful, sources of knowledge. And this is one of the challenges which we are looking at in higher education today. We use words like decolonization of knowledge or ecologies of knowledge, the opening up of the treasury of knowledge which exists in the world. And we're struggling with this in terms of our curriculum. How do we broaden out from basically a Eurocentric curriculum, which exists in most universities around the world, to a curriculum which is inclusive of diverse knowledges, historic knowledges, or the knowledges of situated peoples? How do we change or modify our research so that it begins, and recognizes diverse knowledges? What is the implications for movements like Black Lives Matter, or the movements of Indigenous peoples, or the inclusion of excluded peoples, such as my doctoral student who talked about the exclusion of knowledge of students of generational poverty? And what about ways of constructing or sharing knowledge? Knowledges come from poets, from artists, from musicians, from dancers. So all of these forms of these kinds of knowledge, these all can be, you can find echoes, of these different forms of knowledge in the ideas and the thinking of both King and Gandhiji. And some, Rajesh and I talk about this as knowledge democracy. So it's one of the challenges that we face in higher education today. I know, Rajesh, you've thought a lot about, sometimes you talk about as contextual relevance. I wonder if you could share a little bit more what you mean by that and why that's a challenge for us.
Yeah, but on the occasion of the 150th birth year of Mahatma Gandhi, you may remember, but that we organized an international symposium in Delhi in September 2019, and the title of the symposium was Educating the Mind, Body, and Heart: Messages of Mahatma Gandhi. Mahatma Gandhi's educational experiments and efforts were directly linked to everyday life. He, even in the ashram schools, he wanted students and their parents to support garden, support food growing, food cooking, but students cleaning, washing. And what he emphasized in that is that all aspects of knowing, you have to stimulate your mind, yes, but you have to also stimulate your body and most importantly, your heart. And it's in the heart that your values and your morals are embedded. And if you don't focus on the heart, then your mind alone, what you said earlier, that you know the most dangerous person would be very knowledgeable, but without morals. And we have seen the impact of such inventions and such people in the way society and the cultures and the ecologies are being destroyed. So Gandhi's emphasis was on overcoming the distinction between mental and manual labor. Because India's traditional stratified system with Brahmins at the top gave Brahmins the right to study and control knowledge only in the service of the kings. And Sanskrit as a language could only be taught and used by Brahmins in the earlier years. As a result, the lower order in the stratification was supposed to do menial work, what is called menial work. And modern language, we call it blue-collar jobs. And the white-collar jobs are the sophisticated jobs. And today, that differentiation has reached disturbing proportions because information technology has created this. This divide has increased, and people who are at the top of the information technology world are becoming billionaires and billionaires by extracting knowledge. So knowledge economy has been the fuel for growing inequality in the last three decades around the world, both inside the country and across the world. We have more billionaires now in India, China, many countries of this region, but that has been possible by extracting knowledge, using it for private gain and not for societal benefit. This is the message that Gandhi was giving, that your knowledge can be only relevant if it is used for society at large, for common good, for common purpose. And that's the concept of knowledge democracy that we have been talking about. Because if it is not used for common good, he told a group of engineers who came to meet him once, and they asked him, so do you think we should not become engineers in India, in independent India? He said, no, you should become engineers. We need engineers. But we need engineers for serving the society. We need engineers to look what is happening outside in the neighborhood and address those challenges. We don't need engineers who will focus on personal well-being and accumulation. And in fact, he also emphasized to those who were beginning to establish universities under the British model, he was very strong in saying, whatever higher education you want to do, it must be linked to local context, local language, local culture. Because that's where experiential knowledge, lived experience, people's wisdom exists. And we cannot ignore that if we want to develop an independent nation, an independent India. I like one of his best quotes. He said that, universities do not need majestic buildings, because in the early days, we were all setting up buildings and campuses and putting boundary walls. And he said, universities do not need majestic buildings. They need intelligent backing of community and public. Intelligent backing community and public. If you have that, you have a higher education institution, which is contextually rooted and serving society, linking new forms of knowledge to existing forms of knowledge. So that is the way Gandhi focused on higher education. And I think in today's context, when we have faced this pandemic and when we are destroying our own planet, there is a wisdom in what he was saying, and there is a relevance to what we have been talking about in terms of knowledge democracy. And a land-grant university like University of Western Virginia and many others in US actually were set up for that purpose. You know more about it than I do. So perhaps you can comment on, you know, what kinds of models are there in these land-grant universities and how they can serve the communities around which they have been rooted.
Thanks very much, Rajesh. One of the things Gandhi wrote actually quite a lot about education, and he supported the development of higher education institutions. So we have a little bit more complete idea about what he thought. King, on the other hand, didn't write a lot about education. He didn't speak a lot about education. So we have to derive, you know, what kind of an higher education system, or what kind of higher education he might wanted to see evolve if he as time goes on. So, you know, we can certainly infer from his life's work that the kind of higher education he would support would be based on, for example, on the truth of the histories of slavery in the U.S., with the notion of colonial oppression throughout the world. Some people don't know, but King actually was in Ghana in 1956 for the independence of Ghana, the first African country to receive political independence from the UK. And he was there with a lot of African-American civil rights leaders who were there. It's a history and a story that few people know about. But he also visited India, of course, because of his devotion to and being inspired by the work of Gandhi. But he would, of course, King would support, you know, all of the moves that are being made in universities, including, you know, West Virginia University, towards a more inclusive knowledge, a more action-oriented, engaged student experience, towards research based on community rather than kind of individual needs. He would certainly, I think he would be proud of the initiatives being, supported in emerging from West Virginia University, and he would be he would have been very happy with the continuing work of the institution also in Appalachia, which Rajesh and I have had quite a lot of contact with, Highlander Center. And Rajesh, any connections you can make with the Highlander story with regard to Gandhi or King?
Well, thank you, Bud, because I was saying that I have not visited Morgantown or the University of West Virginia. But I've been in the Appalachian region at the Highlander Center. And I was there at the time when it was modeled. Looking at create rooted in the local soil continues to be, and this is a very important part of my own learning from there. The second thing that I want to add, I know there is a bit of a trouble on my internet. We are supposed to be the digital country of the world, huh? But we supply it to you guys. We don't develop it ourselves, so it's okay. But let me just say a couple of words before I conclude, because I think it's important to say something about the significance of global solidarity. Why this conversation today, and in the manner in which you all at the university have organized it and hosted it is so critical. We are at a juncture where economic inequality has gone through the roof. We are at a juncture where climate destruction is vast, rapid, affecting us every day around the world. The pandemic's impact is also enormous. It has shown all other forms of discrimination and exclusion. It is important that higher education institutions rededicate themselves to working with local communities, developing local solutions in order to create local hubs of action, solidarity within a global network. So the Knowledge for Change Consortium that Bud Hall and I worked to support emergence of now has 23 hubs in 15 countries around the world, and the hub at University of West Virginia is the first one in US. But each hub works locally, contextually, yet connects with other hubs globally. So a model of globalization, which is creating knowledge and solutions for local solidarity, local action, local community-led solutions, economic, health, water, these solutions, but connected to global solidarity. So the previous model of globalization from the top needs to be now already falling apart, but rejected through a concerted effort of globalization from the south. So let me stop here, Bud, and you may have some closing comments.
Yeah. I'd just like to add to what Rajesh said and to acknowledge the West Virginia University and the Eberly College for their support and the community of Morgantown and the region for their support in creating the Morgantown West Virginia University Knowledge for Change Hub. And that hub is led by Lupe Davidson, Professor Lupe Davidson, who works with a really brilliant team of engaged knowledge workers who come from both the community side. They are knowledge workers in the community and the university side. And I just want to name Cynthia Gorman, Amy Jo Hutchinson, Shanequa Smith, Jessica Wilkerson, and Bradley Wilson as people who have who are doing remarkable work in strengthening community university ties, very much in the spirit of Gandhi and King. I'd like to, to wrap up. We would like to wrap up our part of the conversation with a clip. The favorite song of Martin Luther King, the favorite civil rights song, some people think was "We Shall Overcome." That was certainly, the anthem that we still are drawn to. But his favorite song was "People Get Ready." It's a wonderful. We've got a version of it here, done by his one of his favorite groups called The Impressions, and Nikita, our colleague, and Priya has added images of young people from higher education in different parts of the world. So we would like to wrap with that video clip. So Nikita, please play that.
People get ready, there's a train a coming. You don't need no baggage, you just get on board. All you need is faith to hear the dealers humming. Don't need no ticket, you just thank the Lord. So people get ready for the train to Jordan, picking up passengers. coast to coast.
Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you.
Rajesh and Bud, I think I speak for everyone participating today, how much we appreciate your thoughts and insights and your commitment to these very, very strong ideals and values that both Gandhi and King would support. And really through your work, their work continues. And I just want to say thank you. I failed to mention earlier before the talk got started that if you have any questions, and we'll have a few moments for Q&A. And if you have any questions of these gentlemen, please feel free to type them in the Q&A box. I see that there's one already, but let me kick this off though by asking both of you. You no doubt understand that particularly in U.S. society right now, we are perhaps at one, if not the most divisive time of our country's history. And clearly, many of your comments today speak to how we bridge that divisiveness. But maybe if you could talk a little bit more specifically about institutions, both in terms of community organizations, but also institutions of higher education, how we directly deal with that divisive nature.
Yeah, I can. This is a challenge and a context which is not only being experienced in the U.S., Greg. It's being experienced to a lesser degree in Canada. It's being experienced in many, many, many parts of the world, you know, in Hungary and Brazil, you know, in Turkey, in France, you know, to some degree in the UK. You know, and how do we understand it? For one thing for me, I think that history history is cyclical. It swings. It moves from time to time. It's a kind of spiral of change, where we kind of move. We encounter challenges, and I think one of the things that's terribly important is not to stop, you know, building and moving forward on the, you know, the types of education, you know, pedagogical ideas, curriculum change, institutional reform, that is in the spirit of social justice. Because if we pull back, if we say, well, we've got to, things are getting out of hand, and, you know, we've got to, you know, quit talking about something or other, because it's we're living in a divisive, then we will lose, you know, we'll lose momentum. And as you brought forward the full sentence of Gandhi's sentence about the long arc of history, and how it is bending towards justice. I just believe that we will find a way through, and obviously every opportunity we have to talk, you know, amongst each other and to be open. And certainly the ideas of nonviolence, if ever we needed to think about what the implication of nonviolence would be, it's in a world, you know, where some people have an awful lot of guns and other people don't. So those are just a few thoughts, but it is a troubling time. But the other thing to just keep in mind is that while it's a troubling time, there have been so many extraordinary achievements of young people and older people, Indigenous people, Black people, you know, people, all kinds of, you know, street people, women who've been, you know, experiencing gender violence, and they are finding ways to come together and to, you know, resist and build. So that's ongoing, and that's going to continue.
Thanks so much, Bud. I'm going to read some questions that have come in, and either Rajesh or Bud, feel free to jump in and take these on. I think your notion of democratization of knowledge is a valuable way to describe land grant education. Could you tell us more about how it, as well as your own approach to educational challenges, meritocratic views of education, providing education for the best and brightest? In what ways does it shift our focus as teachers and learners? So I guess talk a little bit about your own experiences in terms of your work in this area.
Rajesh, you could take that.
I want to give you an example of something that was launched on Friday. It has taken us 4 years to work with a group of like-minded academics with the University Grants Commission of India to create a course called Fostering Social Responsibility and Community Engagement. It's a compulsory 2-credit course for all students, all 40 million students enrolled in India. It's going to be rolled out. But the essence of the course is to take students to communities, to vulnerable and excluded households, and to listen. To listen about how they experience life, how they cope with life, and to listen and understand how they innovate solutions despite their hardships. And from that, then find ideas that they can build on through their own formal education. Now, this program was launched on Friday. This program is going to be rolled out in the coming period. We are going to train master trainers in community-based participatory research from several hundred higher education institutions in the country. And from the July term, July semester, the first batch of students will go. The most important issue is that community engagement and social responsibility is now a part of the curriculum, and teachers have to also learn to respect those who they thought could not enter the university and therefore perhaps were not smart enough like the students and teachers inside university. I think this is one example of a potential shift that will happen to what the young people will learn going forward. The second example I want to give is from the work that we have been doing in this Knowledge for Change. And we have one of our first hubs was in Durban University of Technology. And they have been combining the messages of Gandhi with the concepts of Ubuntu in developing, and Ubuntu is a formidable African cultural normative value system, and trying to inculcate in students inside the university system to look at the world outside with those lens, which are inclusive, which are respectful, which are not sympathetic, but more empathic to local communities. And I think teachers have a most critical role in this. Teachers, young researchers, they are the ones who can actually promote, facilitate, accelerate such shifts. Because my experience of young people is that they are not only interested in remaining inside a classroom to learn, and they are increasingly frustrated with the kind of life and work balances that they find. So they're looking for ways to learn at the same time to contribute. And I think this is where a potential role of teachers and deans and others in universities is very important.
Thank you. As you probably are aware, there is some trends in higher education, at least in the U.S. Higher education, that seemingly downplays the role of humanities and social sciences towards more professional, technical, practical approaches, which might lead to professional opportunities in the labor force. Is this an apt description based on what research is showing? And if so, what approaches besides local community action can challenge academic settings in more humane directions?
Let me say a word or two about that. Yes, I think what you're describing, Greg, or the person who's raising that has described is true. There is a move, you know, you read the Ministry of Higher Education in Japan has stopped all funding to humanities, for example, and all of this emphasis on STEM is coming. But there is resistance as well. Because this is precisely what King in his early days was speaking about. He said, if efficiency is the only measure of quality education, then we're lost. He talks about as Rajesh has also reiterated, he talks about the reason without moral values, and this is the old story of the head and the heart. And so there is a trend, there is a trend, but there are, one of the things about higher education is it is a space of contestation, and it's a human space. It's created by people, and there are a variety of requests for higher education. So you might have some global businesses saying what we want are flexible, multi-skilled, multilingual workers to plug into the international, production train, global production. But at the same time, you have voices, and I think Rajesh and I are among those, and there's a large number of global networks, the Talwar Network, the Global University Network for Innovation based in Spain, the Association of Commonwealth Universities. There's organizations within, the UK. I think of the National Coordinating Council for Public Engagement in the UK and the Living Knowledge Network in Europe and so forth. There are, and it's a trend. It's a trend. It's not a flash in the pan. It's not, the Bud and Rajesh show. It is a global trend for thinking seriously about social responsibility. UNESCO is holding an international conference in May on higher education, and the focus of it will be on social responsibility and the commitment of higher education to achieving the United Nations Social Development Goals. So it's, as I say, it's a space of contestation. There's a lot of perspectives, but the perspective which you are representing through the vision which you are trying to institutionalize at Eberly is part of a very exciting kind of global movement, which is also a very important trend.
There's another question that I think ties right into your point, Bud. The question is how can land grant universities design and include courses on democratic knowledge in their concepts of their curriculum? So do you have some specific suggestions about how that could work?
I think Rajesh can.
Let me give you two very potentially useful examples. In November last year, all the member states of UNESCO signed on an agreement called Open Science. And it is first time in the history of last 500 years of discourse on science that this open science framework includes indigenous knowledge, experiential knowledge, practical knowledge, lived knowledge, and knowledge of the excluded communities. This is has been agreed to. And therefore, we are trying to now start a course for young scientists, young researchers who are coming out of universities, who are doing their doctorate or postdoc, to understand this framework of open science, because this will prepare them, sensitize them to other forms of knowledge, other forms of epistemologies. The second very interesting possibility that is that global citizenship education has come out on the agenda of many institutions in the context of the pressure for protecting our planet and our communities. And the knowledge perspectives in global citizenship education will entail understanding the cultural, linguistic, and knowledge system of the other. And therefore, I think land-grant universities are especially well-placed to be able to create courses, not just for students of social science or philosophy, but engineers, technologists, biochemists, physicists as well. And I think this is an opportunity for us to prepare them to appreciate that instrumental rationality of lab-based science derived from the pillars of STEM is actually one of the causes of destruction, not just a solution. Because we assumed that natural resources are unlimited.
Thank you. I want to conclude with one last question, and this is to both of you. The question goes, with careers dedicated to democratizing knowledge, you both have rich experiences on which to draw. What causes you to hope for the future, and what would you prioritize for action to realize these hopes today?
I'm very optimistic. I have been all my life. I've been working in, my early work was the academy made fun of me. They said I was, as a young scholar, I was, too ambitious. And let me talk about University of Victoria, where we're trying to, like every place, we're trying to tackle these things. So in the public administration school where I work, we have a working group on, it's called decolonizing and indigenizing the curriculum. So that's a very practical thing. It's been going 5-6 years. It's taking time, but we're having, it's amazing the impact, the difference now from 5 years ago. So I think the creation in the higher education institutions of working groups, they need to be, discipline or, located as well as coming from the top. I think that that's a really important one. Secondly, a priority is, which is happening at many institutions, is recognizing for career advancement purposes that engagement work, whether it's engagement in supporting student, engagement in the community or engaged scholarship, community-based research, it takes time and it has different kind of results. And if we can recognize, if we can create, career advancement practices that recognize this kind of knowledge democracy, it's going to be, a big, big help. And there's a lot of other practical things. I think the book, Rajesh and I have just done a book last 6 months ago called Socially Responsible Higher Education. I think Elaine LaBerge from UVic has posted it, the location. It's free, it's downloadable. And there's stories about practical things that universities are doing around the world, you know, as in order to move this forward. But I thank the whoever asked that question. Thank you very much. Rajesh, any final thoughts?
I'm grateful to the pandemic. I don't know about your part of the world, but in our part of the world, for the first time in my lifetime, and I, you know, you read my CV, I'm electronics engineer, my first degree. First time in my lifetime, science, scientists, scientific funding has been debated on the streets by citizens of this country, because all kinds of medicines, all kinds of tests, all kinds of jabs, all kinds of boosters, all kinds of people for the first time paid attention to science, scientists and scientific enterprises. And I think public accountability of science is growing in this context. And that makes me very hopeful, because the day science, scientists and scientific research funding institutions become socially responsible, we would find a very different order in the future. So that makes me hopeful, and that's the direction. I'm going to work with scientists now, young scientists.
Well, I'm glad to leave on a hopeful note. I want to thank our guests, Dr. Rajesh Tandon and Dr. Bud Hall, for being with us. I also want to thank them for partnering with our collaborative at the Eberly College and WVU. Comments that you made throughout your remarks about the importance of community engagement and really how that ties very nicely to the land grant university is really what I think our college is dedicated to in terms of working to serve the people of West Virginia and beyond. And it's a pleasure to work with both of you in that effort. I want to thank everyone who's been able to join us today. And I also want to thank Lupe Davidson, who's organized this event, and Dylan Butler, who's assisted her. As we go forward, I think it behooves us all to reflect on the values and the goals of both Gandhi and King, and do our very best to live up to their very high aspirations of our humanity. Thank you all, and I hope to see you sometime soon.